Good afternoon. So what is it to be covered in the morning? Anybody can summarize in a sentence?
What is geosynthetics and their different types like geotextiles, geomembranes, geogrids, and how they form their manufacturing?
Thank you. So we actually initially trace the history of development of geosynthetics. What was the need which is felt actually in making these products developed, which we call synthesized for use with geological materials? Then we said there are basically four varieties of these, four groups of these materials. We said they could be geotextiles, geogrids, membrane, geomembranes and geocomposites. And we said they are a generic kind of classification. Under each one there are several varieties again. We also said that there are many other varieties, but their actual consumption is very small, but they are required for specific activity in a given, say, system, let us say landfilling or pavement or something other now. So we also try to understand through the process what is the possible likely use of this, what can be done with this. So what they do actually is known by technical word function of these materials. There are classically now, I should say, five primary functions. We will see what exactly they are: separation, barrier, filtration, drainage, reinforcement. Something automatically comes out of these names itself. And then there are other functions which today we are classified as per ISO, comes in same category, but I would like to place them as a secondary kind of functions, which are surface erosion control, protection, stress relief, essentially for bituminous pavements. Now there is ISO standard on how to represent them also, because tomorrow we are going to make a drawing, let us say, either CAD or by hand also. We had to represent them actually in the drawing where they are going to come up basically. So that is the basic representation as per ISO. Typically we will see what exactly they are. So first is separation. Now separation really means that we are trying to separate two dissimilar kind of materials. Finest example will be, you have a subgrade here, pavement subgrade, which could be clay or whatever it is, soft material. There is some geosynthetic here. And then there are aggregates kind of thing here. So we are trying to separate these two things. What was need, we will discuss a bit later. But then it becomes necessary, particularly if the CBR value is very low. That means CBR value low means 0.5, 0.75. You can't put your leg also on that. You will sink actually. So if you want to dump your aggregate on that now, natural aggregate, you will get sunk into that now. So we need a separator basically. That is one of the primary functions. And in fact, I should say that 70% of the roads in US actually use geosynthetics for separation and other things which you are going to see. Consumption, I mean. So barrier. Barrier essentially for water or any other fluid flow, even leachate flow in landfills, and also for gases. Because, you know, the waste you are producing, it emanates gases whenever biological decay occurs of the materials. And how to do that? Otherwise, you will all full of gas only. So we have to control that, collect it and use it if possible, and not make chai, you know. Out of that. So that is separation function. So what it is trying to do, the leachate is trying to come down, but then it is not being allowed to come because this becomes a barrier. So what is a, which type of geosynthetic performs this? Geomembrane performs this excellently. Then we have filtration. So filtration really means that some flow is likely to occur, particularly downward or vertically upward, basically on gravity. And this is what is happening, that the water is able to pass through, but the soil is being prevented. So that is what is called filtration. And this filtration is always flow across the material. This is what you have to see. It could be vertical, it could be horizontal flow, but in both cases, the water is allowed to flow by gradient, and then the soil particles are not allowed to move, because the soil particles are moving now. In a case of a dam or something like that, there will be piping actually. There will be erosion of the soil particles, it will be just lot of damage. So that is something which we are going to prevent. The drainage we mentioned already. So that means in this case, it is flowing along the member, what we call as a planar flow, whether the material is vertical or at a inclination, it is going to be allowing this to happen actually. You can see along the, this one it is going to move. So animation credits to Homith. Okay. In this now, the other kind of thing is reinforcement. We said that the woven geotextile is quite strong actually. We said the strength could be quite high, and then what is going to do? It will reinforce in the direction in which it is placed. Later we will come to know, though it is going to take tension, but we are in soil mechanics, we are dealing with only soils which are definitely compressible, they got good compressive strength now. The soils can't take care of tensile loads obviously, but you know, the way they are being presented, the way they are being laid now, the vertical loads or compressive loads will be transferred onto the member as tension. That means it creates by friction a tension, and which is going to be taken care of by presence of this member. It could be a woven geotextile or it could be a uniaxial kind of grid. Okay. So then these are the first five main functions. Can you repeat them? Separation, drainage, filtration, reinforcement, barrier. So these are the five things. And obviously, when you say barrier, do we think of a grid? No. Isn't it? When you think of filtration, drainage, now what do you think? We will think of a non-oven geotextile. Isn't it? So if you think of oven geotextile, yes, it could be generally for reinforcement. Generally, there are specific cases when we make special kind of materials, and then we also need for erosion control, be it be hill slope erosion, be it be coast erosion, we require many kind of materials for erosion control also. So that is what we are trying to depict actually. So that is what is happening, it allows water to flow down. It is not going to get into the body and then cause the erosion or piping or something. Surface erosion is of course there, could be piping also later. So that is being prevented in many ways. We will see there is a biotechnical way of doing it, there is a mechanical way of doing it, there are different ways in which you control erosion, there is a way also in which you try to construct structures actually which take the wave action also into effect, which takes the tsunami load also into effect now. So there are many kinds of applications, and this is one of the most important topic actually so far as India is concerned. Then protection. Protection, you can put it under the earlier head also, but here what we mean is protecting a membrane. Membrane we said is a barrier actually, okay, but by itself it is not strong. It is definitely not as strong as geotextile, it is not as strong as a grid also. So it requires certain protection, because you know we may put even 50 to 100 meters of waste material over that, now it is going to be under lot of stress and strain because the base also is not perfect now. So it will be bent and things like this. So, and during construction, during dumping the waste also, it can get damaged now. So that always, membrane is always covered, sometimes on both sides, sometimes on one side with a geotextile. Okay. And it's like, you know, somebody catching the cricket ball. What is going to happen now? If you hold it, I mean, I don't break it now. If I'm trying to hold it now, naturally my hand is gone. You allow certain little bit moment now. Now that is provided by non-oven geotextile. A cushion is being given actually. It will take the impact actually, it will not allow the bottom below what is there, geomembrane, minimal damage is going to be there. So they are testing also for that now. So that is called protection now. In fact, in the early days, when we get samples of membrane, we always have to couple with that, a geotextile is stapled and given to us. We didn't know why they are, maybe we thought it's a marketing gimmick, but we think it's most important actually. So same way, protection we are talking of, stress relief. Now quite a bit of the roads, both asphaltic pavement, that means bituminous roads surfacing, as also concrete roads now, they are subject to damage due to heavy traffic and due to poor construction now. So when you are superposing on that now a new layer, like what is happening on the highway now from Gandhinagar to airport now, you are putting a layer now, and I am sure next year I come, again they are going to put a layer now, because they didn't do anything, I am not talking about quality construction, what they are doing is that there are stresses in the system now, the stresses are going to be tensile also. So bitumen contact tensile stress to that level, it is better than soil. So what is going to happen is, you put a layer there which will take care of the tensile stress now. There is a lot of design involved in that, but in India, this is called as SAMI actually, stress absorbing mineral layer actually. So the mineral layer is being replaced with a geosynthetic now, such is done in Jaipur, we will talk of that when we go to payments now. So that is stress relief layer actually. So that is the kind of thing, here it shows actually a jointed payment, a rigid payment, or which you are going to place this, and then naturally the rest of the construction will go on, be it bituminous, normally it's bituminous cover over rigid overlay. Now what happens is that any layer you are going to place now is subject to bending. So bending means bottom tension. So that is going to cause naturally likely crack in course of time, and that crack, if this is not there, naturally is assisted by the weak, by the gap which is there. So naturally, that crack is going to be going up. So this is not going to do. This, what is going to happen now? It will go and take care of the tensile stress which is going to likely develop now, because there is a natural system. So any overlay, as we call it, is not complete without use of a geosynthetic now. But then you should remember that here also we are talking of geosynthetic, we talked earlier also geosynthetic now. Here we are talking of a layer of bituminous layer now. You know, bituminous layers are laid at given temperature. Usually anywhere between the laying temperature could be 110 to 120, 130 also rarely, but 100 plus is the value now. So a normal geotextile may get damaged in that. So here we are going to place actually material which is thermally stable. Okay, so in a terminology now, we call them as asphalt grade geotextiles. Okay, the other thing is that when we are going to place anything like this now, it has to, you remember, we are using a layer system for design of pavements. One of the assumptions always, there should be continuity of contact. That means these layers, whatever we place now, has to stick to the bottom also, has to stick to the top also. So we need a kind of adhesive now. So today we use glass grids effectively, which ensure that it is sticking to the bottom, sticking to the top also. So there is a kind of glue at the bottom. There is a bitumen coating such that at the top it is going to stick to the bituminous layer, usually BC, bituminous concrete is going to be at the top now. So you see, the design comes in, it is not a glass grid. Glass fiber has got very high strength, very high modulus, which is required for a bituminous overlay, because in the top layer it has to be best actually, both in strength as well as high tensile capacity. And then we will put this material which is going to stick to that, which will give strength higher than the bituminous layer we are going to lay. Isn't it? Reinforcement means you are reinforcing the original material. Because of the material weak only, we are adding this material. So this sticking capacity, this gelling with bitumen, they become important. That is where we say product development actually. So there is a factory right here in Ahmedabad which makes world class materials actually of glass grids. I think we will not take you there. We will give the address and give the contact number. There are many such factories just around here only. Okay, the next class could be end of the month. But then before that, I would expect you to visit all of them and learn and make a very brief 5-minute presentation, each one of you, on those factories you visited and what is it you learned. Because whatever I have done in 1.5 hours, you can also do in half a day, visiting the factories. Okay. Then of course, what are the polymers which you are going to use? Well, listing is very long. Polyethylene, you know, you should remember, when tomorrow I say PP, it should automatically think that polypropylene, PVC, polyvinyl chloride, and then polyamide. Okay, then CSP, then EPDM. No, we should teach or learn polymer chemistry. Should we or should we not? Okay, but yet we should have working knowledge of that. Okay, so for example, you say polyester, PET. Okay, now what is it? There is a basic resin now, and there is something called an additive, there is a plasticizer, there is a carbon black pigment. So the first point we want to make is, we are going to use first grade materials. That means the moment they are made only, we are going to use it now. We are not going to recycle, you know, like our plastic bottles are recycled and you can't make a juice out of it now. It should be what we call as original materials, number one. Now though I may say my shirt is polyester shirt, the polyester which is here now is not the same polyester. Why? Should be same? You have additives to better perform, to give us higher strength or higher modulus, okay, or thermal resistance. So there are additives which are required. So when you say polyester or PVC, anything you say that, it is not always a pure form of it now. It has always got some additives now. Minimum it is going to be 2% carbon black now. So the point we are going to look at is, you see, the pigment is going to be varying, as you know, but what is the most important part of it is, in PVC there is a filler, there is a plasticizer. So when we say PVC, the actual resin is only 30-40%. It is something like vaguely like PPC and OPC. OPC may add flash, it becomes PPC. Now can we add 100% flash? No. How much you can add depends upon how we are going to grade the PPC. Same way now, we need to have all these kinds of chemicals to be added to that now. Usually it is not very high, but in special application it is going to be very high. Suppose you take polyester now, it is not going to be there. Actually polyester may not require this also, may not require carbon black, because polyester is strong against ultraviolet rays, but still as common practice they may add, it is up to them. Then these are materials, CSP, EPDM, Have you heard of them? Don't worry. So they are actually synthetic plastic. It's called synthetic rubber. We don't normally use them. Okay. Then what about polystyrene? What is polystyrene actually? I think you know thermocol. What is it? All thermal insulation is done by that one. Okay. Or it can also give in very thin sheet form also. The point is that we are not using it, but blocks of thermocol can be used to fill up embankments on very soft soils also. We are not going to deal with it, but that also comes as part of overall geosynthetic family. We are not dealing with it now. So, what are the most common ones? I will repeat. It will be PP, polypropylene. It will be polyester. And then PE. In PE, naturally, we are going to think of HDPE, that is high density polyethylene. So, these are three, four things which you should remember and its characteristics. Out of them now, what is going to be important for me is going to be specific gravity. Oh, you see polyethylene, specific gravity is 0.96. And polypropylene, filament and staple, 0.91. So, you can see the other ones are higher than 1. What does it mean actually? If it is less than 1, they are going to float in water. Isn't it? So, when you are going to waterfront structures or subsea structures, naturally we should take care of it. Not that we can increase the density, but we can weigh it down sometimes if required. Mind you this. So, whatever Professor Venkatraman is going to show you later, we had weighed down also those sheets which are going to make, vessels are going to make along with geotextile, weigh it down because otherwise it's going to float. We should remain in contact with the bed, whether it is a river bed or canal bed or whatever it is. So, that becomes important. Otherwise, we are not really worried. And also, what it means is that per gram, it's going to give you more surface area. Here, we are going to have lesser, by more weight, you are getting lesser quantity actually. So, mind in business, it makes a lot of difference now. Okay, 1.22 is very heavy density, I mean heavy specific gravity compared to 0.91, 30% higher. So, you remember this also. So, then of course, the thermal coefficient, we are not so much about that, effect of heat now. So, polyester, 252-90 degrees, whereas other ones are definitely 140-170. You don't remember these values really. But remember that the melting point of polyester is going to be high. So, if I were there, I would prefer this actually for my payment applications. Though PP is allowed also, but preference is given same cost now. Why I am talking of same cost is, at given point of time, let us say for the last 20-30 years since I am into this business of teaching the subject and research, the polyester is very expensive. So, very few used to make polyester material in making geosynthetics, unless it's otherwise required. Today, polyester is cheaper than PP. So, naturally, you should learn the basic principal characteristics of these things. Just understand what is going to come out of it. Other important thing now, nylon. Why nylon is coming up now? Why don't you use nylon actually? Can we use or not use? You see this capacity. The breaking tenacity they call, that is the strength actually. Okay. Now, the fiber is so fine, the filament is so fine, we can't use a normal unit for our, like we said, we are going to change from KPA to kilonewton per meter. In the case of this fine fiber, there are two words which is said denier. Denier really means the weight of 9000 meters of a filament. Tex actually means 1 by 9 of that. That means tex is the weight of 1 kilometer length of the filament. Okay, so that is how they define. Now it is gram per denier, converted into what you call newtons and things like that. So that is the unit for their basically strength now. You find that though polypropylene is there, filament is stable now, this has got quite high strength. This is also resistant to cement. So I am going to use something in combination with cement now. I will prefer PVA or nylon. PVA is nylon actually. Okay. So, that is important for me. It's expensive actually. I don't normally use it. But when you are forced to use along with concrete due to some reason now, I can't really use PP and polyester. I will use only nylon preferably. So, they are not the standard grade materials, but they are used. So, to the rest end, you should have your own information, which will give you also. But remember these few points which I mentioned about this. So, then what about the damage? So, they can be damaged to ultraviolet light, temperature, oxygen, humidity, and many things are there. What is of concern, of course, is going to be ultraviolet light and temperature. Why I'm not bothered about other things now? In general, if you talk of pH, actually, the PP is stable, if you see the literature, from anywhere from pH 2 to pH almost 12. So PP and PEs are actually quite stable anywhere from pH 2 to, that means highly acidic to highly alkaline. But come to PES, that is polyester actually. Polyester is also called PET, PES also, or sometimes PTA, polyethylene tetraphthalate or something like that. So all the three are used for polyester. So we find that this material will be damaged easily because of certain constraints actually. So that is what we are going to remember. And other materials we are going to take care of by using the carbon black. Now here we see that photodegradation, we are going to call it. So the PET is very good. This means actually very good resistance. PP, very new resistance actually for this one. And hydrolysis is not a problem. Chemicalization is not a problem. All kinds of trouble. PET actually forgot to mention, that is stable only from probably pH 3 and higher to pH 10 only. So if you got very high alkaline environment, there is a problem with this, or very high acidic environment also. So that is why people are afraid of using polyester in such conditions actually. So you should remember this, because you know, we are not talking of only water reservoirs, we are also going to talk of reservoirs for chemicals also, storage of chemicals also, under the ground or over the ground. So in those cases, this becomes very necessary for us to remember now. So then, what is the other thing which you have to remember, of course, is the chemical nature of that. Okay, chemical nature of this is decided by two factors as we are concerned. Again, you know, neither I'm expert in polymers nor you are going to be. But two points I have to remember about the polymers is that we have to bother about the molecular weight. The higher the molecular weight, it is supposed to be better. So the molecular weight we are going to require, the next slide will come, at least 20,000 upward is better for these things. In the same way, the damage or loosening of this crystal actually is coming with what we call as carboxyl ends. It will be showing. So polyolefins is damaged, I already mentioned, molecular weight and carboxyl end groups. This also, there is a limit they are going to be. So that means when you are talking of polyester shirt or polyester sheeting somewhere else now, we are not using that polyester. It is a special polyester or special PP or special HDPE which we have select, which has been made now. In our country, they never used to make like that. Today, of course, Reliance makes what is required. That is why we are able to make world-class materials. Okay. So that is something we have to basically remember now. So this is what is coming now. For coated geogrids and high-strength geotextiles, the molecular weight required is 25,000 above. And for non-ovens, it doesn't matter so much, it is 20,000 because, you know, it is not a strong structure. Whereas the CEG, the carboxyl end groups now, so we require actually CEG less than 30 or greater than less than 30, and here also it should be between 40 to 50 for non-oven geotextiles. And in general, the environment which we are designing is only between 3 and 9 actually. If it is going to more than that, we require larger thickness and larger variations. Why I am trying to talk of this also is that this is the only material which is known for containment of nuclear waste also. It is done in, of course, cellars and things like that, but the containers for them are completely lined with these membranes only. So that is why all these aspects come into picture. We may not bother on a routine basis, but then these have been used extensively, are still being used under extreme conditions. So very quickly, review, separator, reinforcement, drainage, filtration, all three are there. Energy absorber means our cushion kind of thing. Container, liquid container we can make it, barrier we can make it now. So all of them are going to be there now. This is difficult to read, but what I am trying to say is that there are these functions which you mentioned. There are these kinds of things. By the very nature actually, some of them are good for something only. Everyone is not suitable for everything else. That is something we have to remember now. For me, we have to change this slide. So we find that you can't simply say everything is going to be good for everything. Non-oven is not for strength. Non-oven could be for separation, let us say. A membrane is again for a barrier. Okay, like that now, automatically, if you know the physical nature of that, if you know the way in which it is made, if you know the chemical with which or polymer which is made, it ultimately should give an idea in your mind, bhai, this is good for this kind of thing, by common sense. Okay. Then we see that the applications we are looking at are going to be of four kinds, as I said already in the beginning. Applications are going to be for geotechnical engineering, for hydraulic engineering, in environmental engineering, and highway and airport pavement engineering. So we ought to have basic knowledge. Supposing you know how to design a ethanol fuel dam, then only I can teach you how to introduce geosynthetics in there now. If you know how to design a pavement, airport pavement, then only I can teach you, or we can learn about how to design airport pavements with geosynthetics. And again, we will say why we want to use it now. We had two options with us earlier. Is it going to be an option? Is it required, essential? When it is essential, naturally, the cost is not going to come into consideration. You should remember very clearly, I think even Venkatraman will say that also, almost all the renovation, the airport runways is being done along with geogrids, along with glass geogrids. It started with, in fact, Madurai and Ahmedabad long, long ago, maybe 30 years back. But then they were using only strips of non-woven geotextile. Today, glass grids are used to cover the entire runway before they are renewed, actually. All the military airports, including Chandigarh, we know many airports, actually, without your knowledge, they are all always laying this and then only covering it now, which gives you longevity, which gives you performance, which gives you all season performance. And like we have said, we have overpaid, overlaid a pavement in Jaipur. It went through three seasons of summer, severe summer last 2-3 years. Nothing happened to this. Earlier, every 3 months they were relaying, actually, because, you know, there is the, our madam chief minister was always going over that due to some reasons. And because of that, actually, they had to renew completely. Renewal completely stopped now. In one lane, one side, actually, we had to have two layers of geosynthetics. Other lane, we put one layer, working perfectly. No further damage. So, that is, what is happening is, this is ultimately the performance counts, isn't it? And why I am saying performance counts is, sometimes we don't know correctly what is the methodology also. Very surprising. That means, one technology, wherein the use is proving correct, all right, I still don't know the theory. There is a friends like Mohan are working on, how is working, we don't know. Correctly, strictly, we have theories. We have 1, 2, 3 theories, actually. But then, which one is the best theory to fit into our conditions or fit into, let's say, Japanese method doing it now? So, that is where the scope of our work is always immense.